Nothing same remains. Hope has deserted me. Time has changed her visage. Now, rivulets of pain course down my face instead of smile. When I see she who stood by me can't stand, whose eyes I saw the world through, can't see. She who taught me to write, can't write. She who lifted me when I stumbled, can't help but stumble.
I didn't know what MS was, basically. I didn't know what it was. And then I wasn't able to stand, I had to keep sitting. I couldn't dance well. I was very upset about that. And I like to teach through dance. And I couldn't do that.
Yeah, actually, I did not know anything about it. See, what the first time he told me was, like, according to the MRI report, it was like there's some vein in the spinal cord which has got twisted, has got suppressed and got twisted towards the right side. Like the covering, the myelin sheath has become bad. The scars have have smoothened out, so there is no protection. It has got twisted and it's got towards the right, so there is no blood circulation towards the right side, and that is why the numbness is towards the left side. So that time I was like, okay, fine, maybe this is the problem. So now he's going to give me steroids. And after my first dose of the injection itself, I was like very fine. And there was no tingling sensation in my back or my foot or something like that. So I was like, okay, fine. That time I didn't take it. Okay, fine. I'm getting all right.
My first reaction was, I was very embarrassed. Now think that in 75, right? This was a year after I joined the police. Right? Now, about that time, I noticed that I could not maintain my balance. Now, this, when I realized this, when I was on the prayer ground, right? At that time, it was very embarrassing. I didn't know what to say, right? And I was too embarrassed to talk about it to any doctor. In 1976, right, after the Ganpati festival, I was in Akola. Akola is very communally tense. And the bandhavas there is a very tiring experience. After that, I got admitted to hospital for overexhaustion, very severe. Sorry, the doctor diagnosed overexhaustion, but looking back, that was one of the first attacks of MS.
I didn't know anything about it. I didn't. And I didn't want to know also. But then, because it was not a happening that was occurring very often in my surroundings. And after some time, it took me a long time to realize what it was. And then I went to Bombay to get the... I had a very bad headache. To overcome that, I went to get the MRI scan in Bombay. I didn't understand anything from those pictures. But when I took it to Ichaporia, he said, yeah, you have it. Initially, I was a teacher, I told you. I was very happy teaching little children because their purity gave me so much. But in a school, there is a principal, there are the teachers. Outwardly looking at me, I look fine. And they thought I just was making a fuss. So I just scrapped the job. I gave it up. And Dr. Mazumdar told me, why are you leaving the job? I told him I couldn't go into the details of the principal, all the other teachers. I didn't. But I gave up the job. That's the first thing I did.
It's the loss of hearing that affects me most, because that isolates me from people. My inability to walk and to isolate me. my the stuttering of my speech is due to stroke, which is due to MS, affects communication. My inability to hear affects communication. So all to all, right, I'm isolated from people. That is very difficult. It's very difficult.
When you cannot communicate with people and people find it difficult.
People find it difficult. People find it difficult to communicate with me. That is people apart from my friends and my family. I have as many friends as most people do, right? But my problem is this, I can't talk on phone. You see, you begin to realize that a phone is something very, very essential to living.
So you don't take any phone calls?
I get phone calls, you see, I have people at home. They help me to communicate, right? But you can't communicate intimately through a third person. For business purposes, for work, you can, but not for intimate relations.
I came to Pune when I was in 11th, and my husband and I stay in the same building. So we got to know that time, say I was in 11th, 12th, we've been going around since that time. So like, you know, when I got this first attack, at that time I was very, very friendly with the family itself. So it was known like to everybody. It was like not hidden from somebody. Then when he came to know, even he was shocked. But then he was like, okay, fine, you know, it's going to get all right. At that time, the first attack, no one really realized. Illness is as serious as not, you know. But you can, when you see this patient of having someone like me, MS, you cannot say she is a patient because I'm not ill otherwise. Only when I get this attack, then I am down. I am quiet, you know, my movements are slow, whatever. Otherwise, I can do the normal routine that I've been doing every day. So when he came to know, he was very worried. He was like, you know, theek hai, now it will get all right. But the second time, no one really expected. So when he came to know, like his parents had come to see me in the hospital that time. So his father knew about this. Knew in the sense he had understood what is exactly the problem is, and he accepted with it. But then afterwards, my grandparents and my parents were kind of worried, you know, like since I've been going around with this person for, say, 5-6 years, and suddenly we have been going around the whole town all these years, and like, you know, marrying somebody else or not marrying, or, you know, it becomes a big problem for a girl. But then when all this happened, they took it very lightly because his parents had asked him, you know, like, you want to live with this girl who's going to have this problem all her life. So he was like, yeah, I mean, I love her and I've accepted her. I mean, what if it would have happened after marriage? What if it happens to be? So, and his mom also said the same thing. She's like, what if you have a hand fracture or your leg or hand breaks, you can just cut this part and throw off. No, you have to live it with it. So I think that was a very good thing. I mean, I used to get very tensed, like literally hyper. Like when I got the second attack, I was very depressed, very, very depressed. You know, then generally, you know, all the frustration comes out on Amol, you know, it's Amol, are you going to leave me and go, you know, such questions. Then he just generally sends me all the small mails and cards every day from the office, like, at least cheer up reading those. Then he got this frame and put it over your mate for each other, don't get depressed. So, you know, he just generally doesn't, you know, gets flowers for me, something like that, he goes on, you know, he's like, you know, to keep you smiling is the biggest work that I have got to do, he's like, don't get worried.
My family is very supportive. Yes, my daughters. Yes, they blamed. There were many things that normal mothers do and I couldn't do. And they blamed. I suppose they'll blame it on me only, no? They did blame it on me. They still do, I think.
Like, for example, what kind of things you want?
I can't cook now. See, my hands shake a lot. I'm not able to bake. I'm not able to do all the things that I used to do.
So it has...
It's a deterrent. Yes. Yes. I used to sing. I can't sing. I used to love to read. I can't read.
How do you spend your day?
How do I spend my day? I clean.
My day is very much like others, right? I wake early, I wake up with tea, I tend to my garden, then I bathe, I get ready, I have breakfast, I go to work. I get to work by about 10, 10:15, and I work until 7 or 7:30 in the evening. Nowadays, after work, I go to the race course, I walk around there, I walk one round, which comes to 2 kilometers. Then I go out sometimes, meet some friends, come back home, do some work, have dinner, go to sleep. Very normal day.
What was the most thing that you miss?
But the most I miss is conversation. Now that's not due to MS, right? And a full-fledged career. I'd say what I miss most is a full-fledged career. That is, what I miss most of all is the entire opportunity to work, to use one's talents. I felt that by staying on in the bullet set, I might have done an unwise thing. Because in a department like the bullet set, the opportunity with these handicaps, they're very limited. They're very limited. Though I enjoy my work tremendously. But I feel outside, in other areas, especially now with computers, there's much more I can do.
There are many times that I do want to dress. I do want to walk down the steps. I do want to go out. I do want to meet people socially. And those are the times when I cry the most. I normally don't cry. But everything is so difficult. It's so difficult to try and put on my clothes. It's so difficult to try and dress. It's so difficult to try and put on a lipstick, which I think I should do, but I cannot do. Because I have a friend, and she got the Haas Award for the education. And I so badly wanted to go and be part of this celebration. And I didn't want to show myself the way I am. I cried the whole evening. My friend came and she hugged me and she said that I've come to you now. I said, but your coming to me is not the same as me coming to you and celebrating with you. She said, you sent your husband, but that's not the same as me.
Can you tell us how you are coping with your...
One copes at various levels. One way of coping, the fundamental way, is making oneself go through the motion, no matter how one feels. Like something, for instance, something like a daily walk, right? No matter how I feel, I push myself through a daily walk, no matter how I feel. That's very important. No matter how I feel, I force myself to get up and go to work. You see, over the years, over each day, forcing oneself to do something one doesn't feel like makes things easier. Makes things easier. At another level, it is something very, very personal. Very personal. I get a lot of comfort from the study of Buddhism. But that has to explain why these things happen. You see, unless you can explain why something so strange happened, it's not possible to cope. So, philosophically, one's got to find a reason. If one doesn't find a reason, coping is very difficult.
How has this changed your looking at life?
It's one takes nothing at the surface. One accepts nothing at the surface. One tends to go deep into everything. One tends to look deep into every experience. One tends to take nothing for granted. I can't really put it better. But one doesn't accept things at face value.
And I went to various people, yeah, psychologists, doctors, but I couldn't get any help. The kind of help I thought I needed, I got that with my prayer. With my prayer, I was able to do my own introspection. And yes, that has helped me.
This prayer you were doing just now, what does it mean?
It means that you have the power to bring out. This prayer is the Lotus Sutra. The Lotus Sutra is that you have the power to bring out the lotus in you, no matter how much of muck that this lotus is in, it will flourish. And if you yourself believe in the flourishing of this Lotus Sutra, that it will happen. It does happen.
I think someday it's going to go. I am going to do whatever I want to do in my life. In the sense, I have to do my CA, I will do it. Any other course, anything professional, whatever, personal, anything in the house, in the family, it's like I don't want to be restricted by this illness. I don't want that illness should have a command over me. I should be able to have the command over my illness.
Thank you.